Yeah, good morning, everybody. At the outset, I'd like to thank Professor Sinha for the opportunity to present some of the recent work we've been doing. And I continue as in the same topic of discussion of this morning session, which has been on various aspects of semiconductors. And I continue with dilute magnetic semiconductors. And these materials have been were of great interest, especially about 10, 15 years ago, when people were exploring alternate technologies to the current electronic devices, because with rapid miniaturization, what is happening is that the size of your device is reducing, and their efficiencies so you'd be going into the nano regime, and so what would happen is that their efficiencies would fall once you enter this regime, and the people are exploring various alternate technologies. And while the current technologies, electronic devices, are based on manipulating the charge degree of freedom of the electron, in this area, which is broadly called spintronics, one wants to use the spin degree of freedom of the electron. And what I'd like to explore in this talk is whether we can increase the, basically, if you want to manipulate the spin degree of freedom of the electron, you would like to have the spin degree of freedom available to you at operating temperatures, which are typically room temperatures. And that's why I'd like to explore quantum confinement as a route to enhance the Curie temperature of these materials. So this is a schematic where if you had the spin degree of freedom active in these materials, what you could do is, in contrast to the current electronic devices where you would use an electric field to manipulate the charge, you'd also use a magnetic field to manipulate the spin degree of freedom. And this has been a conceptual route based on the current ideas that exist of the devices towards spintronic devices. Of course, no device has come about as yet. So what I'm going to basically talk about is, well, if I want to use dilute magnetic semiconductors, then how, if I explore the various materials that have been used in this context, and one of the most famous examples is manganese doping in gallium arsenide, what I find is that I'm limited by the largest magnetic ordering temperature that I can have over here. This is because I want to have a source of spin polarized electrons at room temperature, and a source of spin polarized electrons is easily available if I could make the material ferromagnetic. And so what is found is that I take the example of one of the most well-studied and well-characterized semiconductors, and manganese doping in this in gallium arsenide represents one of the most well-characterized examples. And what one finds is the highest Curie temperature, ferromagnetic ordering temperature, that one has found over here is at 12.5%. And as you can see from this experimental data taken from this paper, what you can see is that the magnetization vanishes around 200 Kelvin. So the highest temperature that they've been able to achieve so far is just 185 Kelvin. So now, recent experiments brought in an additional puzzle to the problem, when what they did was they took manganese doping and gallium arsenide, and this had a doping percentage of about 5% manganese doping. And what they found, and typically, as I said, the largest achievable ferromagnetic transition temperature is of the order of 185 Kelvin, and at this composition, it's lower than that. And what they found was that the bulk magnetization measurements had a smaller TC, a TC much less than 185 Kelvin. And however, when they carried out photoemission experiments, which were spin resolved, so what is shown here is the spin polarization. It's just the spin polarization of the density of states, and as a function of the depth from the, this is the Fermi level, and as you go inside, and you can see that at the Fermi level, you have a significant spin polarization, and these experiments were done at room temperature. So this was a big, this seemed to be a big puzzle, that how could you have, why do bulk sensitive measurements like bulk sensitive magnetization measurements find a much lower Curie temperature compared to these experiments, these photo emission experiments. Now, so before we go try to understand this, we need to take a step backwards, and what we want to understand is why would a surface sensitive measurement of manganese doped gallium arsenide find spin polarization at room temperatures? And so we need to know what is the basic electronic structure of what happens when you dope manganese and gallium arsenide. So essentially, what's already known, if you try to dope manganese and gallium arsenide, where would the gallium manganese atom go? So typically, most of the manganese atom in this case goes on to replace, to substitute the gallium site, and it replaces it, if you think that it replaces it isovalently, then manganese should have a D4 configuration over here. So in that case, what some experiments, essentially photo emission experiments, probe where the electron, probe the density of states of these systems, and from that you know where the manganese states are. And if this is a schematic representation of the band structure of the semiconductor, so this is the it should not be VBM, it's the valence band of gallium arsenide, and this is the conduction band of gallium arsenide. And what you find are the manganese states are deep inside the valence band of gallium arsenide. So if you have a D4 configuration in that case, what you would have is that you would have a hole deep inside, because you would have a hole deep inside the valence band which doesn't seem correct, because you can't have states which are unoccupied over here and states which are occupied above that. So what happens is that what is believed to happen, what was the original idea, was that, well, what's going to happen is that a hole from an electron from the top of the valence band is going to make the transition down and fill up the state. And so what you have is that you have a, these are the majority spin manganese levels which are occupied, and you have a hole at the top of your valence band. So essentially the basic representation of the electronic structure was that you have an isolated spin associated with the manganese atom, and you have, which is interacting with this hole in the valence band of gallium arsenide. So this was the basic representation that one had of the electronic structure. But then when we carried out, when we looked at where are these, so one way of doing that is if you have a valence, what we wanted to see was where are these acceptor levels associated with this manganese doping, because what manganese is doing over here is it's introducing a hole, and so it's acting as an acceptor for the semiconductor gallium arsenide. So when we looked at it across semiconductors, only what we find is that on a universal energy scale, where we plot the relative band offset, so what you have here are the locations of the various valence band tops in each of these semiconductors, and this is the position of the conduction band bottoms. What you find is that only in the case of this on gallium antimonide, you have the this particular acceptor transition almost degenerate with your valence band top, but in every other case it's significantly deep inside the valence band, which again suggests that there is significant, a simple valence band hole picture of manganese doping doesn't seem appropriate when we're looking at where all these semiconductors. And so what we said is, okay, this it seems to suggest that manganese is actively interacting with the lattice. And so based on various various ab initio calculations, we constructed a basic schematic level diagram which could represent our electronic structure results. So how do I understand it? So let me guide you through this thing. So basically, before the introduction of manganese, since manganese is substituting the gallium site, what you can think of is that you have this part. So the only states which are the system before manganese is introduced has a gallium vacancy, and as you have a gallium vacancy, you have these dangling bond states which are localized on the nearest neighbors of the gallium vacancy and are located slightly above the above this line, which represents the valence band maxima of gallium arsenide. So then what manganese is replacing a gallium site, and over here it has a tetrahedral coordination, so it has a it has four arsenic neighbors, and these arsenic neighbors should generate an electrostatic field, which split up the five-fold degenerate d orbital, the degeneracy of the five-fold degenerate of d orbitals. And what you have in this case is you have this, you end up with levels which have E symmetry and T2 symmetry. And additionally, manganese would like to sustain a local moment. And so you have the majority spin, which I've denoted as plus, and the minority spin, which I've denoted as minus. So essentially, these exchange split levels of manganese interact with these dangling bond states. And the symmetry of these dangling bond states is T2. So what you can expect immediately is that these levels, which have E symmetry on manganese, have nothing to interact with on the dangling bond states. And these effectively remain non-bonding, whereas the T2 levels interact with these, forming bonding and anti-bonding levels in each spin channel. Now, when I fill up these levels, what I have is I have a picture where I have this hole which I was talking about in the context of manganese doping and gallium arsenide as a valence band hole. I actually have it in this band which is formed as a result of this interaction of manganese with these states, with these dangling bond states, and essentially resides in an impurity band. So these, so this can explain, so depending on the, and as you can see, what you can see is that these, as I change my semiconductor, you can just forget about these positions. What I can, so these are my, the valence band maximum of these different semiconductors on a universal energy axis. And the dangling bond states effectively in each semiconductor would follow the location of the valence band maxima. So essentially what I can do is I could effectively tune the position of these states and therefore change the character of this whole state. And indeed, this is what we find in our calculations. When I go to the case where manganese doping and gallium nitride, what I have is that you have the EF over here. This is the Fermi energy. And what you have is that the whole state has significant manganese D character. And this decreases as we go to gallium phosphide, to gallium arsenide, and possibly gallium antimonide would represent the case of your hole in the valence band. And the schematic which I had shown earlier in the which was constructed by examining these densities of states, and then this was we arrived at the schematic for the electronic structure. Well, so far so good. This was a model which we constructed. But how do we put this into firmer footing? And in order to do that, what we did was, well, we wanted to put it into a model Hamiltonian framework. And so what we did was we said, let's construct a multi-band Hubbard-like model. So basically what we did was we have gallium arsenide. We so the active states, you can think of a tight binding model for representing the gallium arsenide holes. And additionally, what we have is that there's a coupling between the manganese and the nearest neighbor arsenic atoms within this tight binding model, as well as Coulomb interactions were considered at the manganese site. So what we did was we estimated various parameters which enter this model by fitting the ab initio band structure for manganese doping in gallium arsenide, but at a different doping percentage of 25%, and use this to estimate various the hopping interaction strengths which enter the previous model, as well as the to get a number for what is the bare energy difference between the arsenic P levels and the manganese D levels, the relative on-site energy differences between these, which I denote as delta over here. So essentially, our model calculation was able to describe the electronic structure of manganese doping and gallium arsenide quite well. And indeed, even within these calculations, what we find is that the manganese states are deep inside the valence band of gallium arsenide. And at the Fermi level, the state which we have has significant weight on the arsenic neighbors of the manganese atom. And this is to be expected because your dangling bond states have dominant weight on the arsenic nearest neighbors of the manganese. So within this, well, we have this this description. So the question is, so what we have here is that we have, so the question is, we have the relevant energy difference between the bare arsenic P levels and the manganese D levels is found to be 0.53 eV. But in my schematic energy level diagram, what I was talking about was basically the interaction of manganese with the dangling bond levels. And to get an idea of what is the, what is this number when I, how much is it when I'm talking in terms of the dangling bond energy, what I did was, you can think of a two-level model. And if these two levels are degenerate, then you'd have equal weight of the manganese on both these states. So therefore, we examine that. And so on this scale, this would represent the zero of energy with respect when the manganese states are degenerate with the dangling bond states. And what bulk gallium arsenide represents is this point over here. Well, that's so far so good. But now we also know something, that in the case, this basic energy difference that I'm talking about is not a fixed quantity, because the valence band maxima can be tuned, even keeping the semiconductor a constant, as a result of quantum confinement effect. And let me, although this is a busy view graph, let me just guide you through this, taking the example of gallium arsenide. So what is plotted over here is the position of the valence band maxima, as well, and this is the position of the conduction band minima for quantum dots of gallium arsenide as a function of size. So what you can see is that for very large sizes, this approaches a limiting value, which is expected. But as you decrease the size of these quantum dots of gallium arsenide, this is going to move deeper and deeper. So what we did was, therefore, in contrast to the bulk system, we can tune the relative positions of these states that the manganese levels are interacting with. And therefore, what we did was, we varied that interaction strength. And this represents the case of bulk gallium arsenide. But as I'm decreasing the size of the particle, which in my model is entering as delta, okay? So what is happening is that, as you can see that as I'm bringing the dangling bond states closer to the manganese levels, I'm decreasing the effective separation between these levels, and as a result of which, I can actually change the character of the whole state, which had very little manganese character, and I can increase it all the way down, and I have significant manganese character over here. And this is consistent with earlier literature, where the work by Samesh Sapra and others, from D.D. Sharma's group, what they showed was that as they considered a tight binding model, changed the size of the nanoparticle, and examined the size of the examined the character of the whole state, and as you decrease the size, they also found a significant increase in the character of manganese character of the whole state. And the consequences of this is that as what you can see is, we examine the stability of the, we consider a pair of manganese spins which are ferromagnetically coupled as well as antiferromagnetically coupled, and what this effectively is represents is the first neighbor exchange interaction strength. And as we varied this, as the quantum confinement was varied, what we found was there was indeed an increase in the ferromagnetic stability in this case. And the similar trend was found in all the other exchange interaction strengths. And we took various samplings of disorder and calculated the transition temperature within a Monte Carlo calculation. And indeed, as we find that the trend is represented by this result, and we find an enhancement in the Curie temperature as the size is reduced. The same, so how do we compare with the experiments? The same effect could be seen also in experiment, but what you would have is, the surface is playing the role of confinement over here. And so when we calculated the ferromagnetic stability of subsurface manganese atoms, we have an enhanced stability vis-a-vis this ferromagnetic stability deep inside deep inside in the bulk. So therefore, what we say is that the surface in this case is also playing the same role as quantum confinement, and this microscopic model is able to capture the basic electronic structure of manganese doping in various 3-5 semiconductors, and the surface could play the role of providing a confining potential, explaining the enhancement in the magnetic transition temperature in these materials compared to the bulk. So how much? Yeah. So since time is up, I'll just move on to the people who've actually involved. So the people who've actually done this work, this was primarily done, started by Hirak and then completed by Basudev with some contributions from Poonam, and has recently appeared in PhysRev.